Hello everyone, welcome to my YouTube channel. In today's session, I'm going to talk about Flip Sydney. Before moving to the session, do subscribe my channel to get the further updates about the upcoming lectures. Yes, Sir Flip Sydney was born in the year 1554 and he lived up to 1586. He was said to be the most prominent figures in the Elizabethan age. He was born in an aristocratic family. Of course, his family was very affluent. And he was educated at Shrewsbury Schools and Christ Church, Oxford. And he was the eldest son of Sir Henry Sidney. His mother, Lady Mary Dudley, Dudley, she was the eldest daughter of John Dudley. He was the first Duke of Northumberland. His younger brother, Robert Sidney, was a statesman and a patron of the arts. He was the one who created the Earl of Leicester, L-E-I-C-E-S-T-E-R. Mary was his younger sister, whom Sidney dedicated his longest work, the Arcadia, after her brother's death. After the death of Sidney, Mary reworked the work Arcadia, which became known as the Countess of Pembroke's Arcadia. Flip Sidney was lucky enough to get selected for the Parliament as a member of Parliament for Shrewsbury. And in the same year, he traveled to France as a part of embassy to negotiate a marriage between Elizabeth I, the Duc d'Alencon. Sidney spent a few years in mainland of Europe, moving through Germany, Italy, Poland, and the Kingdom of Hungary and Austria. On this journey, he met a number of prominent European intellectuals and politicians. Sidney met Penelope Devereux, P-E-N-E-L-O-P-E, Penelope Devereux, D-E-V-E-R-E-U-X. He met Penelope Devereux in the year of 1575 when he was returning to England. Flip Sidney completely opposed the French marriage of Elizabeth to the much younger Alencon, A-L-E-N-C-O-N. So because of that, you know, he had a lot of quarrels with the Edward de Vere, V-E-R-E. He was the 17th Earl of Oxford. So later, Sidney wrote a long, lengthy letter to the Queen telling that the foolishness of the French marriage. So because of that, Sidney has to relieve from the court. In the year of 1577, Sidney visited Prague. There he secretly visited the exiled Jesuit, was a priest, Edmund Campion. In the year of 1581, he rejoined in the court. In the year of 1584, he was selected as an MP from Kent. The same year, Penelope Devereux was married, apparently against her will, to Lord Rich. Sidney was said to be the most successful writer in the age of Elizabeth, in the Elizabethan age, but unfortunately none of his works were published when he was alive. All of his works were published after his death. He wrote around 108 love sonnets. It was said to be a finest achievement. These sonnets were inspired from Petrarch and Pierre de Ronsard. Pierre de Ronsard. P-I-E-R-R-E-D-E Ronsard. R-O-N-S-A-R-D. In tone and style and place. So Sidney was said to be a greatest Elizabethan sonneteer after Shakespeare. He dedicated a sonnet to his wife, Lady Penelope Rich. Though he dedicated to his wife, you know, they reveal true lyric emotions, you know, couched in a language delicately archaic. Sidney adapted the Petrarchan octave with the variations in the sestet, which include the English final couplet. It was observed that his artistic contacts were very useful and significant for his lasting fame. During his absence from court, he wrote Astrophel and Stella in the year of 1591. Once Flip Sidney met Edmund Spenser. There Edmund Spenser, who dedicated his work, The Shepherd's Calendar, to Sidney. He also had other literary contacts with his, included memberships with his friends and fellow poets like Fulke Grevely, F-U-L-K-E जी आर ई वी आई एल एल ई, देन एडवर्ड डायर, गैब्रियल हार्वे एंड येरो पैगोस. सिडनी वॉज पॉपुलरली अप्रिसिएटेड बाई हिज फेलो पोएट्स सिंस ही वॉज एक्टिवली पार्टिसिपेटेड इन मिलिट्री एंड लिटरेरी वर्क्स एंड कोर्टली लाइफ. दैट्स वी नो ही वॉज वेरी पॉपुलर इन हिज एज. फिलिप सिडनी पर्सिवेटेड जॉन कैशमीर, CASIMIR, इन ऑर्डर टू कंसिडर अ प्रपोजल फॉर अ यूनाइटेड प्रोटेस्टेंट एफर्ट अगेंस्ट द कैथलिक चर्च इन स्पेन in the year of 1570. Around 1580, Sidney argued for an assault on Spain itself. In the year of 1583, Sidney was promoted as a general of horse. Sidney made a successful raid on Spain forces near Excel in the year of 1586. So at the age of 31, he was severely wounded at Zutphen, Zutphen, Zutphen in Netherlands, when he was assisting the Dutch against the Spaniards. In the same year, he joined Sir John Norreys in the Battle of Zutphen, where he was fighting for the Protestant cause against the Spanish. So during the fight, he was shot in his thigh, and there he was died at the age of 31. So after a few days, his body was taken to London, the place called the Old St. Paul's Cathedral, where his body was buried. But his graveyard was destroyed during the Great Fire of London in the year of 1666. Philip Sidney was memorialized as the flower of English manhood in the Edmund Spenser's Astrophel, and which is said to be one of the greatest English Renaissance elegies. Now let me talk about his literary works. The first one is The Lady of May. Okay, this work was said to be his one of his lesser known works. As Mask, written and performed for Queen Elizabeth in the year 1578 or 1579. So the Mask means it was like a form of festive courtly entertainment which flourished in the year in the around 16th century. It was also developed earlier to this in Italy. It's a one-act play. And it was, the play which draws upon a literary tradition of pastoral and which is, very notable for its allegorical content relating to Queen Elizabeth I, for whom the first production was performed at the Earl of Leicester's court country estate at Wanstead. So Queen Elizabeth was asked to mediate the outcome of the work. Of the work starts like a woman who approaches the queen when she was walking in Wanstead Garden as a supplicant, saying that her daughter, the Lady of May, was two suitors, and there she would like the queen to judge which of the two should win her hand. So having left a crowd of people come into view, there are six foresters and six shepherds. Among them, the suitors, okay? The Lady of May herself and a schoolmaster called Rhombus. After a brief quarrel between Rhombus and the May lady, the two suitors, the Therion and Aeschylus, Therion and Aeschylus, Espialus. Soon after that, the second debate was started between Rictios and Dorcas. Dorcas was a shepherd like Aeschylus. This one was moderated by Rhombus. The queen judges Aeschylus to have won the contest. Aeschylus sings to celebrate. Finally, the characters take their leave of the queen. The play gets over. And this work was published in the year of 1598, without title, in the Sidney's Folio of Arcadia. So the next work is Astrophel and Stella. I mean, this work was written approximately in the year of 1580. It was a sonnet sequence which contains around 108 sonnets and 11 songs. The name, which derives from the two Greek words, aster means star, phil means lover, the Latin word stella meaning also star. So Astrophil is a star lover. Astrophil means is the star lover. And Stella is a star. Sydney was, partly nativized to the key features of his Italian model, Petrarch, but, partly obscured narrative. The philosophical trappings of the poet in relation to love and desire and musing on an art of poetic creation. Sydney also adopts the Petrarchan rhyme scheme. Sydney used them with a huge freedom. The 15 variants are employed. Many literary scholars suggested that the love represented in the sequence may be a literal one, as Sydney evidently connects Astrophil to himself and Stella to Lady Penelope Devereux. After that, Lady Rich. So Sydney and Lady Penelope had been betrothed. For some reasons, the match was broken off, and Lady Penelope married to Lord Rich, with whom she lived for a while, but she was not happy with him. She thought be the Penelope Rich and the wife of Robert Rich, the third baronet. Payne, Payne, Payne and Hunter, they suggest that modern criticism, though were not explicitly rejecting this connection, which leans more towards the viewpoint of the writers who happily create a poetic persona and artificial and distinct from themselves. Thomas Newman had who printed and published in the year of 1591, after the 5 years of Sidney's death. This edition got included 10 of Sidney's songs and prefaced by Thomas Nash and verses from other poets, including Thomas Campion, Samuel Daniel, and other Earl of Oxford. The next work is The Countess of Pembroke's Arcadia. This is also simply known as The Arcadia, which is a long prose pastoral romance by Sidney. And this one was written towards the end of 16th century. Okay, and the first version was finished having completed one version of the text. He later significantly expanded and revised his work. Today scholars, often refer to these two major versions as the Old Arcadia and the New Arcadia. The Arcadia is Sidney's most ambitious literary work by far, and as significant in its own way as his sonnets. So let me talk about the Old Arcadia first. Sidney, of course, might have started an early draft in the year 1570 when he was in his 20s, and his own comments, which exposes that his purpose was humble, and he asserts that he intended only to entertain his sister Mary Herbert from 1577, Countess of Pembroke, his sister. This version was narrated in chronological order, with sets of poems separating the books from each other. It seems likely the Sidney finished this version while staying at Herbert's estate during a temporary eclipse at court in the year 1580. In the year of 1588, for 2 years after Sidney's death, Fulke Grevely, who appealed to Francis Walsingham to stop an unauthorized publication of parts of the original, as we learn from a letter which also serves as evidence for circulation of Arcadia in manuscript form. But Sidney's original version was, forgotten until 1908, when the antiquarian Bertram Dobell, who discovered that a manuscript of Arcadia he had purchased and differed from published editions. Dobell, who subsequently acquired two other manuscripts of Old Arcadia, one from the library of the Earl of Ashburnham, Ashburnham, and the other had belonged to Sir Thomas Phillips. So this version of Arcadia was first published in the year of 1926 in all but Fuliarates, Fuliarate, Fuliarates editions of Sidney's collected works. Now, the New Arcadia. This version of the Arcadia, known to be the Renaissance and later period, is substantially longer than The old Arcadia. In the year of 1580, Sidney took the frame of the original story and recognized it. There, episodes were added. Most significantly, the story of the just rebel Amphialus, Amphialus, Amphialus. The additions more than double and original story. However, Sidney had not finished the revision at the time of the death, the year of 1586. See, the new Arcadia was a romance which combines pastoral elements with the mode derived from Hellenistic model of Heliodorus. Hellenistic, Hellenistic, Hellenistic model of Heliodorus, Heliodorus. A highly idealized version of the shepherd's life adjoins. On the other hand, not always naturally. Okay, the stories of joust, political treachery, kidnappings, battles, and rapes. See, as published, the narrative follows the Greek model. Stories are nested within each other, and different story lines are used. His revised Arcadia was prepared for the press and published in two different editions. See, after the death of Sidney, Fulke, in collaboration with Matthew Gwynne and John Florio, edited and overseen the publication 1519 editions, which got over in the mid-scene and mid-sentence. In the year of 1593, Mary Herbert, she published an edition in which the original version supplements and concludes the part which Sidney revised. Later editions filled in gaps in the story, most notably with the fifth edition of 1621, which included Sir William Alexander's attempt to work over the gap between Sidney's two versions of the story. Other continuations and developments of Sidney's story were published separately. The hybrid editions did not efface the difference between the highly artificial and Hellenized revised portion and the straightforward conclusion Sidney wrote originally. Nevertheless, it was in this form that Sidney's work entered history and reached the wide readers. The old Arcadia was not much popular, but it was entertained a small set of readers for around 400 years with its sensational treatment of sex, politics, violence, and soporifics, mobs, and cross-dressing. It was narrated in sprawling Renaissance prose. The romance comprises five books. It comprises, five books, and according to the structure: action, complication, reversal, catastrophe. It was organized according to the five-part structure of classical dramaturgy, like exposition, action, complication, reversal, and catastrophe. This hybrid structure, part prose romance and part classical drama, which permits Sidney to contain a diverse sense of romance within the cohesiveness of the dramatic arc. The work was often, called as a tragic comic for its combination of serious, high plot, centering on a princess and a duke, a Basilio's household, and a comic low plot which centers on the steward Damatos family. The standard modern editions of old Arcadia. Now let's see the book one. So in the book one, the Duke Arcadia, okay, Basilus, journeys to Oracle at Delphos. Okay, they journey to the Oracle at Delphos, and there receives bleak predictions. His daughters will be stolen by undesirable suitors. He will be cuckolded by his wife, and his throne will be usurped by a foreign state. Hoping to preempt this fate, Basilios, who entrusts the Arcadian government to his loyal subject, Pleianax, and retires to pastoral lodge with his wife. His wife, Zynecia, 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 and their attractive daughters, Pamela and Philoclea. Phiocle. His bury servant Demetres and the latter's repulsive wife and daughter Miso and Mopsa. In a nearby city, Pyrocles and Musidorus pass the night. They are cousins, princes, and best friends. And there are, they are famous throughout Greece for their heroic exploits. Pyrocles, upon seeing a picture of Philokalia at a gallery, was, overwhelmed by passionate desire to see her in person. His wife, Genesia, their attractive daughters, Pamela and Philokalia, and his bury servant, Demetres, and the, latest repulsive wife and daughter, Miso and Mopsa, in the nearby city, Pyrocles and Musidorus pass the night. They are cousins, princes, and best friends, and they are famous throughout the Greece for their heroic exploits. See, Pyrocles, upon seeing a picture of Philokalia at a gallery, was overwhelmed by a passionate desire to see her in person. At the end, Pyrocles disguised himself as Cleophila, was an Amazonian lady, was going about the world to practice feats of chivalry, and heads of Basileus' pastoral lodge, was accompanied by the skeptical but loyal Musidorus, and later was deceived by Cleophila. Cleophila's feminine disguise, Basileus falls in love with her and invites her to stay with the family. When Musidorus covertly observes this meeting, he is overwhelmed by a passionate love for the elder daughter, Pamela, and decides to disguise himself as a shepherd, Doris, in order to gain access to her. When everyone gathered in an arbor to hear the shepherd sing, a lion and bear attacked the party. So Cleophila kills the lion and saving Philokalia, and Doris kills the bear saving Pamela. Cleophila's manly quality leads to Gynecia to suspect her secret male sex, while Philokalia forms an intense sisterly affection for Rakhi. Now let me move on to the book 2. In the book 2, the action was started as the romantic relationship became complicated, like Basileus' retirement foments political unrest, and Cleophila struggles to marry Philokalia while simultaneously placating the jealous Basileus and Genesia. Meanwhile, Doris, ingratiated himself to Demetres and entered his household as a shepherd servant, but was struggling to marry Pamela, who was always accompanied by Demeter's vain and ugly daughter, Mopsa. To avoid rising suspicions that he loves Pamela, Doris addresses all of his significant looks and sighing, singing, and poetry to Mopsa, who already laps it up and fails to notice the heavy-handed hints which Pamela, not Mopsa. Mopsa is the subject of his passion. In an extremely complicated piece of hoodwinking, Doris reveals his identity to Pamela and proposes elopement, and who was elated by the prince's willingness to flee Arcadia with him. Meanwhile, Cleophila manages to reveal his identity to Philokalia, and they declare their mutual love. Their idyll is interrupted by their but unfortunately their idyll was interrupted by a mob of drunken Arcadian rabble who are angry at Basileus for neglecting his sovereign obligations. Cleophila, Basileus, Doris, and the friendly shepherds slaughter much of the mob before finally subduing it. Okay, and the book ends, the book second, which got ended with the establishment of the unusual love square, okay, in which father, mother, and daughter are all violently in love with the cross-dressed Procles. Cleophila, and the loud triangle comprising Mopsa, Pamela, and Doris. It also started the political theme, which expanded in the fourth and fifth books, concerning the implications of negligent government. Now let me move with the third book, book third. Okay, in this book, Musidorus, who narrated Pyrocles of his intentions to elope with Pamela. Okay, Pyrocles, who despise of his own success with the Philoclea, because he is under the constant surveillance of the jealous and enamored Basilus and what is that, Genetia. Doris' elopement was a strategy which started by distracting Pamela's guardians. So he tricks Damaetas into wasting a day on a bogus treasure hunt. He dispatches Miso by telling her Damaetas is cheating on her with a woman in an adjacent village, in the next village. So he leaves Mopsa in a tree waiting for a sign from Jove. The coast cleared, Doris and Pamela head for the nearest seaport while resting. Doris is overcome by her beauty and is about to rape her when they are suddenly attacked by another mob. Meanwhile, what happened? Genetia's passion, which has become desperate, and she threatens to expose Cleophila's identity if he does not requite her love. To distract Genetia, Cleophila pretends to requite her love with aggravates Basilus and Philoclea. In an ill-fated bet trick, Cleophila promises a nocturnal assignation to both Genetia and Basilus in a nearby cave, intending to trick the husband and wife into sleeping with each other. They were hoping that they won't notice that each other is not Cleophila. So they are intending to trick the husband and wife into sleeping with each other in order to enjoy a night alone with the Philoclea. The book ends, the book three, which ended with the double climax, which attempted the rape of Pamela by Doris and the consummated union of Pyrocles and Philoclea. Now let me move on with the book four. In the fourth book, Doris and Cleophila were suffering a major reversal of fortune. Okay, Damaetas, Miso, Mopsa—they go return to the lodge to find Pamela missing. And Damaetas, fearing punishment for neglecting his royal ward, begins a frantic search for Pamela, supposing her to be with her sister Philoclea. Damaetas barges into Philoclea's bedchamber and finds, of course, not Pamela but Cleophila, who was nagged and in bed with the Philoclea, and who is evidently not a woman. Damaetas bolts the lovers inside and sounds alarm. In the cave, Genetia and Basilus, they each started thinking the other is Cleophila, have sex, but recognize each other in the morning. Basilus accidentally drinks a potion that Genetia had intended for Cleophila and dies. Genetia becomes her hysterical and self-incriminating, and offers herself up to justice as the murderer of her husband and the sovereign. Philanax, Basilus' loyal friend, okay, who arrived to investigate the Duke's death and Pamela's fight, he becomes a jealous advocate for executing everyone associated with the death of Basilus. Meanwhile, Musidorus and Pamela fall captive to the attacking mob, but not before Musidorus maims several of them, hoping for a reward for finding the fugitives. The mob heads for Basilus, but is intercepted and slaughtered by Flanax and his men, who started taking the captive Doris and Pamela, who are now primarily suspects in the Duke's murder. So Doris joins Cleophila, okay, Now Dorus was like Phyladius, and Clophilo changes the appearance like Timopherus, Timopyrus, in prison. Pamela demands to be recognized as the new sovereign, but Philanax demands an interim period of investigation and burial before the succession is established. Meanwhile, the body politic erupts into a confused and dangerous tumult about a political succession. Now let me move on to the book five, fifth book. Okay, and this book, which brings an action to its catastrophe, of course. Philanax struggles to maintain order in Arcadia, which is dangerously divided. Some factions support various political climbers, others clamor for a democratic government, and some call for the elections of the two princes whose good looks and military powers had made them very popular. Philanax needs a leader capable of commanding the allegiance of the Arcadians and of bringing justice to Basileus' murderers. Luckily, the sovereign most renowned for his wise, just government, Eurus of Thessalia. Eurus of Thessalia, Thessalia, which has traveled to Arcadia to visit his good friend Basileus. Eurus is also the father of Pyrocles and uncle of Musidorus, but has no idea what they have been up to. Philanax, who persuades the reluctant Eurus to aid Arcadia by assuming authority for the present, becoming the state's protector. The book concludes with a lengthy trial scene. Genesia, Palladius, and Timopyrus are brought forth to stand before Eurus, who presides as judge, and Philanax, who argues on behalf of the apparently murdered Basileus. Genesia's trial goes quickly because she, overcome by grief, wants to die as quickly as possible and gives a false confession of intentionally poisoning her husband and sovereign. Eurus sentences her to death by being embalmed alive with Basileus. Timopyrus is tried next, and Philanax delivers vituperative, oratory, condemning him for cross-dressing, for raping Philokelia, and for conspiring with the Genesia to murder Basileus. Timopyrus is acquitted of murder charges. Timopyrus was freed from the murder charges, but was sentenced to death for raping Philokelia. Palladius is likewise condemned to death for attempting theft of the royal daughter, Pamela. As the convicts are escorted to their executions, a friendly compatriot of Musidorus suddenly arrives with the important information. He has heard about the trial and was predicted the prince's true identities, and feels Eurus should know that he has condemned his own son and nephew to death. At this moment of recognition, Eurus is devastated, okay, but decides that justice trumps kinship, and with a heavy heart confirms their death sentence. With their, heart confirms their death sentence. Suddenly, groans are heard from Basileus' corpse, and to the surprise and delight of all, Basileus emerges from deep coma. All are forgiven. The princes marry the princesses, and the book, this book, which ends with a comic reversal, or. Peripetia, from justice and death to reconciliation and marriage.
Now let me move on to the next work of Sidney, Flip Sidney, which is An Apology for Poetry. And this work is also known as The Defense of Poetry. Sidney wrote this work, The Defense of Poetry, before 1583. And this work was taken its place among the great critical essays in English, yes. And this one was believed that he is partly motivated by Stephen Gosson. Stephen Gosson was a former playwright who dedicated his a talk on the English stage in the work called The School of Abuse to Flip Sidney in the year 1579. But Sidney primarily addresses a more general objection to poetry. In his essay, Sidney integrates a number of classical and Italian perception on fiction. The essence of his defense is that poetry, by combining the liveliness of history with the ethical focus on philosophy, which is more effective than either history or philosophy, readers to virtue. It is also offers important comments on Edmund Spenser and the Elizabethan stage. And this work was published approximately in the year 1595, after his death. Flip Sidney states that there have been three general kinds of poetry. The first one is the chief being religious, which imitated the inconceivable excellencies of God. The next one is philosophical. And the third, imaginative poetry written by right poets who teach and delight. Okay, these are, three general kinds of poetry which Sidney wanted to mention. And this work, An Apology for Poetry, it's one of the most important contribution to literary theory, was written in English during the Renaissance. Sidney advocates a place for poetry within the framework of aristocratic state, while showing concern for both literary and national identity. Sidney responds in apology to an emerging antipathy to poetry as expressed in Stephen Gosson's The School of Abuse. Gosson offers that what is in essence an attack on imaginative literature, and what is at stake in Sidney's argument is a defense of poetry's nobility. The significance of the nobility of poetry is its power to move readers to virtuous action. True poets must teach and delight, a view that dates back to Horace. So Sidney's defense was a significant contribution to the genre of literature criticism, and it was England's first philosophical defense in which he describes poetry's ancient and indispensable place in society, its mimetic nature and its ethical function. Among Sidney's gift to his contemporaries were his respect for tradition and willingness to experiment. An example of the latter is his approach to Plato. He reconfigures Plato's argument against poets by saying poets are the least liar. Poets never claim to know the truth, nor make circles around your imagination, and nor rely on authority. As an expression of a cultural attitude descending from Aristotle, Sidney, when stating that the poet never affirmeth, makes the claim that all statements in literature are hypothetical or pseudo statements. As a traditionalist, gives attention to drama in contradistinction to poetry, drama. The drama, writes Sidney, which is observing neither rules of honest civility or of skillful poetry, and so which cannot do justice to the genre. In the age of Sidney, during his time, anti-theatricality, an aesthetic and ideological concern, flourished among Sidney's circle at court. Theatre became a continuous issue in part because of the culmination of growing contempt for the values of the emerging consumer culture. An expanding money economy encouraged social mobility. But at this time, Europe had its first encounter with inflation. London's theatres at the time grew in popularity so much that by the year 1605, despite the introduction of charges, London commercial theatres could accommodate up to 8,000 men and women. Sidney had his own views on drama. In Apology, he shows opposition to the current of his date, which plays little attention to unity of plays in drama. But more specifically, his concern is with the manner that the matter is conveyed. He explains that tragedy is not bound to history or the narrative, but to laws of poesy, having liberty either to feign a quite new matter or to frame the history to the most tragical conveniency. Sidney employs a number of strategies to assert the proper place of poetry. For instance, he argues against the way in which poetry was misaligned with youth, the effeminate and the timorous. He does all this thing by introducing the idea of which poetry is the companion of camps, and by invoking the heroes of ages past. Sidney's reverence for the poet as soldier is significant because he himself was a soldier at one time. Poetry in Apology becomes an art which requires the noble stirring of courage. Sidney wrote an apology for poetry in the form of a judicial oration for the defense, and it's like a trial in structure. Crucial to his defense is descriptive discourse, and the idea of that poetry creates a separate reality. Sidney employs forensic rhetoric as a tool to make the argument which poetry not only conveys a separate reality, but it has a long and venerable history. It does not lie. It is defensible its own right as a means to move readers to virtuous action. The contemporary impact of Sidney's Apology, which is largely what is that a derivative of the humanistic precepts that inform the work, and its linkage of the rhetorical with the civic virtue of prudence. Sidney writes that there is no art delivered to mankind that had not the works of nature for his principal object. The poet then does not depart from external nature. His works are imitation or fiction made of the materials of nature, and which are shaped by the artist's vision. This vision is one that demands the reader's awareness of the art of imitation created through the maker, the poet. Okay, Sidney's notions of four conceit means that a conception of the work must exist in the poet's mind before it is written. Free from the limitation of the nature and independent from nature, poetry is capable of making things either better than nature bring forth or quite new forms, such as never were in nature. The life and writings of Philip Sidney, which remain a legacy. In the year of 1819, Thomas Campbell, who concludes that Sidney's life was poetry in action. And then in 1858, William Strigant, who wrote that Sidney's real poem was his life, and his teaching was his example. Sidney, the man, is apparent everywhere in his works. A study of Sidney's works is a study of the man. Well, that's it about the work. So apart from these works, Sidney also has written psalms. It was said to be a Sidneyan psalms, which are the 16th century paraphrase of the Psalms into English verse. And these works were translated by his sister Mary Sidney. Okay, so this work we can say this work was the work of Philip Sidney and Mary. See, Mary Sidney completed the book sometime after the death of her brother, I mean Philip Sidney, in the year 1586, and presented a copy to Queen Elizabeth I of England in the year 1599. And the translation was praised in the work of John Donne. Well, that's it about Philip Sidney. Thanks for watching. Kindly subscribe my channel.